This presentation is brought to you by Arizona State University's Julianne Wrigley Global Institute of Sustainability and a generous investment by Julianne Wrigley.
I'm a co-founder of Plastic Pollution Coalition, and I'd just like to say that although I feel that I'm trying to convey a lot of stuff and talk about it with you guys, in working with plastic as my material for my artwork, I was very slow on the uptake to get the messages that I began to learn from working with the material. And I say this because I'd say some of my work started fissuring or breaking into smaller pieces, some of the bags that I used after about the first 8 years. And at that point, I thought, oh, awesome, it's ephemeral, it's organic, it's like us, it's like a plant, it's like a flower, it's like a puppy dog, it's like a cat, you know? And so I started looking into it and realized that's in fact not what happens with plastic. Plastic may photodegrade or heat degrade into smaller bits or by being chewed up or churned or within nature, slammed against rocks, you know, dragged on coral systems, etc. But it actually is still plastic, and it just breaks into smaller and smaller pieces. I'm really excited to go to Charlie's lab tomorrow because just in the last 2 years, I've come to learn a lot of new information about microplastics and microbeads, and I'll share some of that with you guys. Anyway, we co-founded Plastic Pollution Coalition in the end of 2009. We're a global coalition. We're working to stop plastic pollution. Our focus is on single-use and disposable plastics, and we have grown to be over 400 other organizations and businesses around the world who are all looking at this issue. And one of my proudest moments so far in my involvement in helping create the organization was the day that we received an email from the Girl Scouts of America and the Teamsters, and they both joined the coalition the same day. So how many people in the room have heard of the Great Pacific Garbage Patch? Okay, for those of you who haven't, the Great Pacific Garbage Patch is a naturally occurring ocean gyre system. It's created by currents and wind currents and ocean currents, and it is also referred to as the Northeastern Pacific Gyre. It is not an island of trash that we can sail out to as I originally believed that it was. In fact, it is in all of the water strata. It is on the ocean floor. A study just came out at the beginning of this year, the Plus One study, which estimated the amount of plastic that is now being found in the ocean. But we don't have a complete number yet. That is just really an approximation based on the evidence that exists. When I first heard about the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, my original reaction to that was, we've got to go out there and clean this thing up. And I began to ask people who had actually been sailing through it, or you can't actually sail because part of it is the doldrums, but motoring through it, taking trawl samples, doing visual observations. And now we work with about 12 different groups that are part of the coalition that do regular trawl samples and are studying plastic pollution in the ocean. Five Gyres and Algalita are probably two of the most well-known groups that are part of the coalition. They have now done trawl samples and studies in the Atlantic Ocean, the Indian Ocean. They've gone through all five major oceans. But there are 11 gyre systems on the face of the Earth, and they all have plastic in them. We've actually also now found plastic and plastic particulate in ice core samples. So plastic is pretty much everywhere. And unfortunately, I included this as Sue Cone Rockefeller, who's a documentary filmmaker, and this is a presentation she gave earlier this year at a women's conference in China, in Beijing, talking as well about plastic pollution in the ocean. But this is the mouth of the Los Angeles River. I live in Los Angeles, California, and the vice mayor of the city of Long Beach said that they spend $2 million a year trying to stop all of this plastic pollution from washing out into the Pacific Ocean. You can see a lot of it is also polystyrene. She said she would much rather spend that money on infrastructure for their city, including their schools and their fire department and their police department. But at the moment, they spend it on machinery and netting to try and catch the stuff and stop it from going out to sea. Again, plastic is not only a problem, or our single-use plastics are not only a problem in terms of ingestion for animals, but they're also a problem for entanglement of animals, and animals on land and animals in the ocean. This is a photograph from the Mediterranean. It's from Dubrovnik in former Yugoslavia. I guess it's Croatia now. Which is a beautiful place where people go to vacation, and it was sent to me by a friend on a family vacation last summer with his family. This is an image that was taken by Robert Simmons. He's a professor at and a scientist at Georgia State University. This is a more recent image, and he's been taking these kind of microscopic photographic images where he's documenting microfibers and microplastics. Let me just take a moment actually to talk about microplastics, because when I first started learning about this issue a few years ago, we would refer to microplastics, and when we did, what we were really talking about is we were talking about pre-consumer plastic nurdles, which are tiny little balls or pellets of plastic. At this point, I've come to realize that we're actually talking about several different kinds of microplastics and microbeads. So what we're really talking about is the pre-consumer plastic nurdles, so that's before the plastic has been shaped or molded or formed into something. A lot of those escape and they end up in the ocean, they end up in rivers, they end up on around train tracks and places where trucks are moving cargo and things like that. But we're also talking about microfibers, which rinse out when we wash our clothing, if we have any synthetics in our clothing. So those, it's turning out, are a problem. They're a really big problem, actually. I think they may actually be the most common type of microplastic that is being seen when people are studying, doing sampling of microplastics. We're also seeing microbeads, which you may have heard about. I think I might have an image. These are microbeads. So microbeads are teeny tiny, almost imperceptible to the eye, little bits of plastic, which are used in a number of different toothpaste and facial scrubs as a kind of abrasive ingredient. And I'm really proud to say that students, I may actually have included them a little later, but students at UCLA in Los Angeles just got the campus to agree to ban products with microbeads in them on campus. So they're about to phase those out, which I think is really exciting, and attests to the power of a small group of students on a campus to actually bring about some change.
This presentation is brought to you by Arizona State University's Julianne Wrigley Global Institute of Sustainability, for educational and non-commercial use only.